the best way to disassemble and service one of these is to work from left to right, and there is a method to that madness, and that's going to become apparent very shortly. Firstly, if you find that you're pumping up the pressure and vacuum and you can hear it bleeding out around here, then it could be that the Schrader valve's faulty. So we're going to start here, push your finger in underneath, and we're going to pull this circlip off with a pick, nice and carefully. And then the shaft will come out and it'll allow you to pull the trigger off. We're going to put all these parts to one side. So this pin will now push out. And then out comes the trigger. There's no spring or anything in here. And then under here, you've got your Schrader valve. You need a Schrader valve tool to remove that. And you can get that from any automotive store that you'll have around. It doesn't have to be anything special at all. Simply place that in. We'll gently turn it anti-clockwise. And the Schrader valve will come out. The Schrader valve does come as part of the service kit, so you might as well replace it while you're here. Out it comes. Next, we're going to take the selector switch out. This is a number one Phillips. Take this out, and it's just a screw. Then the whole part comes apart. And then this simply pushes out and it will have three O-rings on it, which again are all part of the service kit, and they can be popped out and replaced. Now we're going to pull this gauge off. We just have a pin to the side. We're going to gently press the gauge down, pull that out with some pliers. This doesn't come as part of the kit, but it is a replaceable item. Out it comes. And you'll have a little wave washer. And then we also have the O-ring there, a lower O-ring, and then you can replace that gauge nice and easily if you need to. They sell that separately too. Next thing, we want to remove these two Phillips screws. These keep on the front portion, and they are a number two Phillips. You'll have a replaceable O-ring on the front, which is nice and easy to access. That goes to one side, we don't need that anymore. And then we'll have a plate that will have a valve on it. That has an O-ring and a valve on the back. The valve just pops all the way out, as does the O-ring. Then inside the chamber, we've got a piston, an O-ring, a spring, a shaft, and the shaft's held onto the handle with a pin. So what we need to do is remove the two back Phillips heads. They're again number two. You can see the tools to do this are tools that you're just going to have lying around the house. It really is easy to do. So what I like to do here is to compress the spring by pushing on the piston, and then that will allow me take the handle off the back, I'll turn it 90 degrees and it will slip all the way out. Again, this is a replacement item. It's not part of the kit and it is a wear item. They will wear down where the little split pin will ride up and down on there. So don't be surprised if you see that wearing out. I grease mine, it does help. Then what we need to do is to gently compress one side of this little split pin here. That will slip out and our piston then can then come out of the front of the housing. Gently just squeeze that together. Now push it out one side. Put a bit of pressure onto the piston and it will slip all the way out nice and easy. And this pin is part of the service kit. This now will fall forwards and you'll see you've got your plunger, your shaft and your O-ring. They all separate into their individual components. And then last but not least, you have a backing plate and a little one-way seal. Note how I have this seal placed in here. This seal is not symmetrical, and the opening to the seal must face the body of the piston kit. It goes in that way. Again, this is a service item. It comes in that service kit, so you can replace that. This was actually the issue with mine. What it was doing was allowing air to bleed out of here, and it didn't necessarily affect its function, but I could tell that it was starting to wear slightly. And all it was the metal particles that were coming off of here were rubbing on the shaft, rubbing against the seal. And in my case, all it took for that seal to come back to life was to clean it and then re-oil and grease it. So now everything's disassembled, it's time to clean it. And as I said, I've actually done this the other day, so everything looks really nice and clean, but don't be surprised when you take yours apart to find kind of grease that's all black and oil that's all black. That's completely normal. Wipe it out with a rag, don't use harsh chemicals. Then we have to know what lubricants and what greases to use. These O-rings that are black may very well be nitrile, which means that they'll be resistant to petroleum products. So grease like Vaseline or bearing grease would probably be okay. However, I am not certain that these are not just rubber O-rings. Therefore, I always recommend, if in doubt, use silicone oil and silicone grease. That way, you have no doubt it's not going to damage anything and it's going to offer all the lubricity that you need. Same thing comes when you're cleaning it. Don't use carb or brake cleaners. A rag with a little bit of oil on it will do all the cleaning you need to. And if you don't have silicone oil or silicone grease, you don't necessarily want to go out and buy it. An alternative is red rubber grease. This will be absolutely fine. It's safe and compatible with natural and synthetic rubber components. So use this if you so wish. And just stay away from Vaseline, stay away from petroleum greases, bearing greases, those sorts of things. If these are rubber parts, they're gonna deteriorate them very, very quickly. So firstly, just remove that little seal on the back, just inspect it, clean it up, put a little bit of light lubricant on there, place that back into its hole, like so, place your finger over the end, and then slide the spring back on the shaft and the piston itself, and it actually clips in place, and you'll see there, like that, it's now clipped in. Keep your finger over part of that seal so you don't push it out. There's a hair there. Lightly lubricate inside the housing and also around that O-ring. Place it in. You'll see that the shaft will want to go through that seal. It should be nice and tight. If it just slips through easily, then you need to replace that seal. Now the key here is to make sure that that seal stays flat while we replace the backing on it. So don't move the piston back and forth with your finger, because otherwise it's going to push out. That goes on. Our two little screws go in place. Just go snug. Don't go too tight. And we want to grease the underside of the handle here, which is contacting the main part of the body here. And also place a little bit of grease where this split pin rides up and down. As you can see, I've got some in there. So that goes in. I'm going to take that pin, slip the pin in, like so. Orientate it that way. We're now going to twist the pump 90 degrees. Slowly lower it back down. And then we have the handle, the pump, the piston, and the spring all in place, just like it should be. And then we're going to take a screwdriver and we're just going to open up one side of this split pin. And what it does is it just keeps this tracking much nicer. So turn it nice and carefully with the screwdriver. And that has now opened that pin up slightly, and it will tend to track a bit more evenly as you're pumping the piston. Next step is the cover plate, O-ring, and the little seal, the little valve in there. Again, all replaceable parts that come in the kit. So you can replace those. If not, clean them, put a little bit of silicone oil on the O-ring, and that doesn't matter on the orientation, just slips back in and it should be nice and snug, just like so. We then have the front part of the piston kit, and it's got an O-ring there. Again, a little bit of light oil, a little bit of silicone lubricant on there, and it's got the two screws. They go back in place. We then have our pressure and vacuum selector. These three O-rings can be replaced, and they come in the kit. And a little bit of grease this time around the plastic here, and then a little bit of oil on each O-ring, and that slides back in, and you can grease that housing inside there that way. Put that in. And then we have the selector here that goes on. This is a Phillips number one. Just snug is all you need. It's going into plastic, so bear that in mind. Again, just clean out inside here. A little bit of silicone oil around the O-ring here. You place your wave washer over the top and it will snap down in place up here, like that. And then this will simply press back down, and all it is the O-ring holding it in place. Now that's down in place. Give it a gentle press, take your clip, the first bit in the hole, pull back, it'll slip in. Then what we need to do is to reassemble the Schrader valve. Again, comes in the kit. So Schrader valve now goes inside. Gently press, use the Schrader valve tall and go up until it's just slightly snug. That's all you need. Don't over tighten this. So that's now snug. So lightly oil the shaft hole. The pin goes onto the trigger. The trigger then goes over the Schrader valve. And then last but not least, we have the little circlip. Be careful of these, they like to go flying. The flat side of the circlip must face out. And then we want to gently seat that circlip home. So, get it level. There we go. Last but not least, we need to do the test. Finger on the end, make sure it holds pressure, which it does. Pop her over to vacuum, pull some vacuum. Holding and not leaking. And now you know how to service and repair the Mityvac 8500. I've got this video up here, which teaches you how to use it and some of the pitfalls that people might fall into that could cost hundreds, if not thousands of dollars in repair bills if you don't use this correctly. I hope it helps.